So many of us spend countless hours with our earbuds plugged in, controlling what we hear, what we say, and how we think. But what if, instead, those same earbuds could control how we feel? Sounds super sci-fi, but this technology actually exists. And I'm here to show you what it's all about. Meet the Zen by Nuvana. This is a new stress wearable that uses electrical signals to target a section of your vagus nerve via the ear canal. Now, before you freak out about zapping your brain with electrifying earbuds, I would like to point out that I have extensively tested this device out, and well, I'm still here. But all kidding aside, I will be talking extensively about the safety and mechanics of this device, along with things like Bluetooth and EMFs. We'll also touch on some of the science behind the Zen and how this thing is actually working on a physiological level. And of course, this wouldn't be a type A review without some hardcore data. So we'll also look at how effective it is at lowering stress based on my brain scans and biometric tests. And we will wrap things up with my honest thoughts on whether I think the Zen by Nuvana is worth your time and money. Now, before we get into it, just a couple of quick disclaimers. So a lot of you have been asking me to review this device for a while now. So I reached out to the company and they sent me this one to try, and I am super grateful for that. But they had no say in the content and they are seeing this video at the same time as all of you guys. Also, there is a lot to cover here. And so in the interest of your time, I'm just going to laser focus on Zen and its effects on stress. I'll be covering sleep and some of the long-term HRV stats in a future video. So now that that's out of the way, let's just dive straight into the review and let's start with how the Zen works. And honestly, I think it is way easier with visuals, so let's cue the B-roll. So the Zen system is made up of two major parts. Number one, this hockey puck shaped receiver called the Zen unit that powers the whole device. And number two, these black and white headphones that transmit signals from the unit to your ears. Well, specifically your left ear, but we'll get to that in a sec. Now, after you turn it on, connect it to your phone's Bluetooth, and open up the Nuvana app, you have three options to choose from. Either pure stimulation without sound, stimulation with ambient sound, or stimulation with music. I should also note that these special Zen headphones do play music via Bluetooth, just like the rest of them, but you can only play music through this particular device. So before we go any further, let's just take a quick second and talk about what's actually happening here by looking at the mechanics at play when using this device. Now, as I've talked about in previous episodes, the vagus nerve runs all the way from the brain stem to the upper section of the colon, and it plays a pretty big role in stress management since it is closely tied to your parasympathetic nervous system, aka rest and digest. So really, if you hear anybody talk about vagus nerve stimulation, it usually refers to any technique that stimulates this nerve either via manual or electrical stimulation. So for instance, the Sensate device I reviewed last year is a consumer device that uses manual stimulation through a series of vibrations, whereas this Zen device relies on direct electrical stimulation into the ear canal. And of course, there are a ton of free ways that you can help stimulate this nerve, including everything from cold therapy to meditation and even laughter. But as with anything in the health and biohacking space, it's all about finding the right thing that works for you and, of course, your budget. Now, I personally like experimenting with some of this fringe vagus nerve technology just to kind of see what's out there. But hey, if funny cat videos work for you, then by all means. So back to the vagus nerve, and in particular, its relationship to the ear. And bear with me, guys, we're gonna get a little bit nerdy, but I'm gonna try to keep things high level and pretty fast. So not only is the ear close to the brain anatomically, but it's also the only place on the body where the vagus nerve sends its only peripheral branch. And so this area just outside the ear canal, as you'll see here, is called the auricular branch of the vagus nerve, or ABVN. Now, it's become a pretty big area of focus for researchers in the past decade, and some of the results they're seeing have been pretty profound, including the modulation of brain functions, reflex loops, and even brain chemistry. In fact, a number of these studies have even shown that this type of transcutaneous vagus nerve stim affects the same neural pathways as its more invasive counterpart, the implanted cervical device, which was FDA approved in 2017 for the treatment of things like epilepsy and depression. But this alternative, non-invasive technology simply hasn't been around around long enough to really draw any sweeping conclusions. And so researchers agree that more work definitely needs to be done on this front to really get a better sense of how these things are working and their long-term benefits. Now, I know that was a lot, and I am certainly no Bill Nye, but hopefully you guys have a little bit of a better understanding of why vagus nerve stimulation has suddenly exploded into the market. It doesn't really seem to be slowing down anytime soon. In fact, according to Fortune Business Insights, the global vagus nerve stimulation market is expected to grow 11% by 2026. And so hopefully as market demand rises, we might also see a huge drop in prices for some of these at-home consumer devices, because right now, things like the Zen and even Parasim, they're just not cheap. But of course, I'll tackle all things pricing in just a sec. So now that we've covered the science and the technology around how this thing works, let's dive into the results. And we'll start by explaining how it feels. So when you put the earbuds in and start one of their sensation tracks, you'll actually notice a little bit of tingling happening in the left ear. Side note, sorry guys, I totally forgot to mention that the stimulation thing is only happening in the left ear. It's for effectiveness and safety purposes. Anyway, if you want to learn more, links below. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the Nuvana app includes a ton of stimulation options, either with or without music. And just a quick note, if you do pair the stimulation with your own music, once the stimulation stops, the music's gonna keep playing. So that is pretty convenient. And to show you what I mean, let's run through a quick session setup. So when you open up the setup page and click on the sensation tile at the top, you'll see a handful of different waveforms and sensations to choose from. You're supposed to select a waveform first and then the sensation, but since there are no presets or pairing suggestions, it does kind of feel a little bit like a guessing game at first. I mean, I was certainly a little bit confused and couldn't find in the manual, so I hit up the team to really understand what both these waveforms and sensations were all about. And this is what they told me. The waveforms themselves are the signal being sent from the stimulation, so each one has a different strength, and then the sensations are the pattern in which the signal is delivered. So this is gonna be what you actually feel in your ear. And to break it down further, each waveform you see here from A through F looks different and feels different based on different parameters, including things like shape, pulse width, and frequency. But just know there is no one-size-fits-all recipe for a particular effect here. Certain waveforms could induce sleepiness for some users, but not others. So really the only thing we know for certain is that each waveform is going to feel a little bit different on the skin, with some sensations being more intense than others. So knowing that, I found myself defaulting to some of the higher waveforms for that increased intensity, and my default one tended to be waveform C. Now, when it comes to the different sensations, right now there are 6 options to choose from, ranging from mountaintop to rolling hills. When you click on the individual down arrows, you'll see how these work and what sensations you can expect. As you'll see here, the cityscape sensation tends to be slightly stimulating with multiple peaks of high intensity, whereas ocean waves is a bit more calming due to these moderate peaks of high and low intensity. But again, the playing field, it's totally yours to mix and match until you kind of find that sweet spot setting that works for what you're looking to get out of it. So now let's turn to the data as we take a look at how the Zen actually worked on everything from my brainwaves to stress levels. We're gonna start with my raw brain data. So I spent about a month testing out the device in different locations at different times and under different circumstances using my Muse 2 headband and the Mind Monitor app to record my brain activity. And some of the results I got were pretty surprising. So let's take a quick look at May 16th, for example. So I did this test before bed, starting with a 15-minute brain scan without the Zen. And what I saw from beginning to end was a very steady decrease in all 5 brain waves across the board, with a particularly large dip in my gamma waves. Now, fast forward to my 15-minute session with the Zen using my favorite relaxation setting, waveform C, plus ocean waves. And here I saw some hefty spikes in my delta and theta waves, smaller changes to my beta and gamma, and then a slight dip in my alpha waves. So looking at these results side by side, what can we infer from these very different before and after patterns? Well, knowing that high delta and theta states are typically associated with sleeping and states of deep relaxation, this might suggest that This particular Zen setting was helping speed up the long and sometimes very arduous process that happens at night when I try to shut off my brain and go to sleep. Moving on to the stress component, and we're gonna take a look at some of my biometric data that I collected using my BioStrap. Like the sessions with my muse, I also started with a neutral base, running a full biometrics report on myself both before and after my Zen sessions. And so here I'm taking a look at things like heart rate, SpO2, and this special metric called HRV, low frequency, high frequency, which can be used to indicate real-time changes to your autonomic nervous system. That being said, let's take a glance at my biometrics report from the morning of May 31st. And as you'll see here in these before and after charts, there's a pretty big change in the LF to HF ratio here, which suggests there was a shift from a high stress state to a lower stress state, at least according to the BioStrap. And I gotta say that I saw this same pattern happen a couple more times in my month-long experiment, which could be some sort of correlation between the Zen device and lowering stress. Now, for comparison's sake, I wanted to see what would happen if I deliberately put myself into a stressful state. And so I conducted this same exact test using a music track that I know for sure always gets my adrenaline pumping. And here are those results. So this is pretty telling. As you can see, there is a huge imbalance between the LF-HF ratio here, which implies that my stress levels could also be quite out of balance, this time swinging in the direction of a high stress, high sympathetic state. So taking all my various experiments into account, I think there's some potential evidence here to suggest that the Zen device did show some quantifiable changes to both my stress levels and my brainwave data. Now, I do realize that I didn't quite account for the placebo effect here, which is something I'm definitely going to experiment with in future rounds of testing, so stay tuned for that. But in wrapping up, let's quickly touch on the pros and cons of this device, and we'll start with the pros. So on the plus side, this device is pretty low profile, and it's fairly easy to use, making it very convenient to travel with when you're on the go. Now, the frequency sounds coming out of the headphones are actually very subtle, and this is a good thing because if you are using it in bed when you're trying to go to sleep, probably not gonna wake up your partner. Another thing I was pleasantly surprised with was the overall audio quality. So when you sync it to your phone's Bluetooth, you can actually play music from any streaming service, including Spotify. You can then choose to listen to your music either with stimulation or without, which I think is a really great feature because it means you can use this device for more than one thing. And finally, let's talk about EMFs, since this thing is being powered by Bluetooth. So after some very rigorous testing with my acoustimeter, the Zen earbuds really show no noticeable electric radiation and relatively low magnetic field activity. I would say about half as intense as the signals coming from my wireless headphones. And in terms of radio frequencies, well, the Zen unit didn't really produce any signals strong enough to make any clear discernment between that and just having the background wireless router on. Now, moving on to the downsides, and we have to start with some of the technical issues that I had that I think just makes using this device a little bit of a struggle. So for one, you have to have your phone on standby at all times. And when I mean standby, I mean like no more than 10 feet away from you. So I tried to walk into the other room with the device on, and then I totally lost connection, which meant I had to repair everything and restart the session, which was a total pain in the ass. Another weird thing is that when you want to play music and stimulation at the same time, you have to connect to Bluetooth two separate times, once in your phone settings and then the second time in the app itself. I don't understand why. Then there's light. So this thing lights up with a bright blue and green light every time you turn it on and off. Now, I didn't really have any issues with this during the day, but at nighttime. Now, luckily they gave me a case and I put that on mine, but just something to know, really questionable design there. And finally, guys, we come to price. So this unit itself costs $400, which is pretty expensive for a device so small that literally fits in your pocket. But in doing some research, it's kind of right in line with the other options for vagus nerve stimulation on the market right now, including things like Cove and Sensate. And that's simply because the technology itself is still so new and the pool of competition still so small. Now, once we see more players emerge in this space, I expect we'll probably see some of these units come down in price. So the way I see it is, if you have the means and you want to be an early adopter, great. Otherwise, I'd probably wait 2 to 3 years for a really big market shift and better yet, more published studies to come out on this technology. So that's my take on the Zen device by Nuvana. Thank you guys so much for reaching out and asking me to review it. I gotta say that I'm still using it a couple times a week, and I'm planning to do a little bit more of a long-term study on how it affects HRV and sleep. So stay tuned for that in the next couple months. And if you guys want to see any other metrics tracked by using it, just hit up the comment section below or reach out to me on my DM at @KatieTypeA. Thank you for watching. And if you like this video, you know what to do. Make sure you hit that like button, subscribe, hit the bell, all the things. And until then, well, I can't wait to catch you guys on the next one.